You've survived another week. Thank you for listening, downloading, and subscribing to the Black Man with a Gun Show podcast. This week, I'm talking about cleaning guns. Yeah, not so sexy a title, but somebody's got to do it.
BlackManWithAGun.com, Ken Blanchard's Pro Gun Podcast.
All right, Halloween is over. The elections are over. Daylight saving time is happening. It's still storming down in Texas and Louisiana and Florida, so our friends down there are getting all wet and soggy, never dried out yet. It's snowing in the upper Midwest. Folks are a little bit more irritable from all the wearing of masks and being on lockdown, even though that hasn't stopped the need nor the request to do the same. Some are mad about the statues that have come down, the changing of Confederate flags on state offices and buildings and wherever. Younger parents are going crazy because they have to deal with their badass kids. Some folks are disappointed that the Civil War didn't start yet. And they're still mad about the elections. No matter which side you're on, they're mad. There's been a lot of deaths and sickness, a lot of cancer. And I can't believe how long my list of negative things is. So forgive me for that. But the best advice I can give you for right now is to hold on to what you got. And I got a few other things, about 23, 24 other things that I've accumulated over the years. Number one, always carry a pocket knife. They come in handy more times than you realize. Two, reward yourself for victories. If you're on the fence about purchasing something, maybe you might want to go ahead and do it now. And celebrate once you've completed that project or reached a goal. Number three, when confronted with two options in life, the harder of the two is usually the correct option. In the Army, they say, the hard right over the easy wrong. Number four, one good pair of shoes is worth 10 bad pairs. Cobblers exist for a reason. Number five, you're probably not sleeping well because of your pillow and all the other stuff that I mentioned, but your pillow is probably the culprit. Number six, extended warranties aren't worth it. Believe it or not, if you're going to squirrel away $100 a month on a warranty, you would do better to put that in the bank, so that when that thing breaks down, you can go buy a new one. Number seven, cheap wine that tastes good is still good wine. Number eight, have a notebook for work. Take notes in the notebook rather than on post-its. This way, you can always refer back to your notes for contact information and dates. Number nine, if the worst answer is no, then don't be afraid to ask the question. I don't know who that was for, but that might be a game changer for you. Number 10, focus on what the other person is saying rather than your response. This also works on Facebook. Take your time when responding. And now's a good time, number 11, to send your friend an old-fashioned letter in the mail. It'd be nice to use that thing for other than bills and junk. Can I get an amen, somebody? Number 12, if something sounds too good to be true, it always is. Number 13, fast food workers probably work harder than you do, and they should be respected and treated with respect. 14, I don't know is one of the most honest responses a person can give you. 15. There's no such thing as agreeing to disagree. The first person to use this phrase in a debate is the loser of the debate. 16. The funeral business is a scam. Get cremated if you can. And don't burden your loved ones with the cost of a funeral. 17. Ghosts do not exist. It's probably an HVAC issue. 18. Never shoot or drive after drinking. 19. Always wear a helmet and a life vest. 20. Take the time to iron your dress shirt. People notice. 21. College is essentially just memorizing books. Pass that on. 22. Chemically, a billionaire's happiness is no different than your happiness. You'll get that when you get home. And finally, leave this world a better place than you came. If you like me, tell me. If you miss me, show it. If you love me, prove it. I want to invite you to check out my other podcast. There is the new Ken Blanchard Show. It's a weekly podcast of positives, smiles, love, and encouragement. I don't know where that one's going, but it's there. You'll find it at kenspodcast.com. Then there's speaklifepodcast.com. It's my Christian show to restore and strengthen the family, provide hope for those in need, and offer a non-traditional place of worship using tech to be anywhere. And everybody's welcome, including those who are still searching for what they believe in. And then finally, Indian Motorcycle Radio, for those who love motorcycling, and especially those that love the Indian motorcycle. You'll find it at IndianMotorcycleRadio.com. And for the record, this week, I'm just trying to make you think about some stuff. I mean, I know that long list of negatives might have you want to jump off a bridge, but this week, I'm going to try the impossible. I'm going to try to give you some tips on how to clean your firearm without you seeing what I'm doing. I'm going to try to explain some things, hopefully, that it sticks in your head so that when you grab your firearm later and you're attempting to clean it, that some of these points will pop back up. I know there's quite a few new shooters out there, and welcome to the fight. I'm glad you're here. The biggest thing that you want to do, though, is make sure that you practice gun safety. Make sure that your firearms are not accessible to kids and teens and family members and friends of family that come over and may find your stuff. If you're single and you lock your stuff all up and you live by yourself, you don't have that worry, cool, especially if you're using it for self-defense for your home. But every time you pick up a firearm, make sure it's unloaded. Unless it's your carry gun, unless it's for self-defense, unless you know, everything always depends, but be conscious of your safety. When you're cleaning your firearm, no matter what you're doing, don't disassemble your gun too far. Refer to your owner's manual for instruction. As a rule of thumb, disassemble only to the point needed to reach the areas where that powder residue and the fouling will accumulate, i.e. your bore, your chamber, your bolt, etc. And while you're in here fooling around, inspect your firearm as you clean it. Check for worn parts, for cracks, for signs of excessive wear. Now, if it's a brand new gun, or maybe if it's a used gun in good condition, you won't have any of these problems. But this is a good chance to learn the nomenclature, learn the lingo, learn about your firearm so that when you're on the range, when you're actually shooting, you know that you put a bore brush through here, that you put a patch through here, that you put the lube in the right place, that this dust that's coming out of here is coming from something that you put in there, maybe too much, or didn't happen enough. All that comes from being a responsible gun owner. Now, if you're an old hat and you've been shooting and blowing up stuff forever and a day, and this is not new to you, then I'm going to ask you to be the critic. I'm going to say it, put the critic ear on, the critique on, and make sure I don't miss anything. All right. And then if I do, hit me back up at blackmanwithagun.com so I can fix it for next week. All right. Deal. Here's some of the rules when you're gun cleaning. Number one, always clean from the breech to the muzzle in a natural direction of the bullet. If you can. Sometimes it's hard, especially if you're using like a revolver, to getting your brush or your boar punch or anything to go in the natural direction of the bullet. That's probably the only time it's not that way. When you fire a gun, the powder residue and dirt are in the barrel. The chamber and the receiver are a little cleaner. If you run a brush or patch from the muzzle end, you will push this dirt, this residue, and moisture into the chamber and into the receiver. And this is sometimes a major cause of stuck cases or problems with lever actions and auto-loading rifles and shotguns. If you push or pull a brush back toward the chamber, you will notice the brush will throw the debris from the bore back into the chamber and locking lugs. Number two, center the tip and the rod. Be careful not to let the either rub the bore. You don't want to scratch the inside of your rifling. All firearms record their history. And this is the reason why people look down the barrel of firearms to begin with. An experienced eye can tell the method of cleaning, the number of shots, the gun maintenance applied to the firearm. Many marks are caused by people who carelessly let the tip or the rod rub the inside of the barrel. Number three, use a clean patch surface each time you go down the barrel. This is similar to mopping the floor and rinsing the mop out. When you are using your firearm, you will get abrasive dirt in the muzzle. The patch with solvent will flush this dirt out in the shortest distance. If you use that same patch surface again, the dirt will be deposited in the chamber and neck. The next bullet down the barrel picks up this dirt and erodes the throat. This is the exact equivalent of cleaning in the wrong direction. Number four, never run a brush in the barrel first. This will damage the firearm. The brush will pick up dirt, moisture, or powder residue and deposit it in the chamber or receiver. Never dip a brush in solvent. The solvent at the brush core will collect dirt and drop it in the receiver and chamber. There is kind of like a repeating theme here. Do you feel it? Number five, never go back and forth reversing the brush. This will bend the bristles on the brush. This is the equivalent of bending a wire back and forth until it breaks. You'll always ruin a brush if you reverse it while it's in the bore. You might even feel that the rifling grabs a hold of it and the brush wants to twist. Yeah. And number six, use only a few drops of solvent or lubricant. Some folks think more is better, but not the case. This will damage the firearm again. Use only the solvent that will patch will absorb. If you see too much, the solvent or oil will drip down the trigger mechanism. And this will be gummy. You don't want gummy. If you use too much oil, it'll drain back toward the stock and cause premature failure of your furniture. Mm-hmm. Now, when we have polymers and stuff, that doesn't happen. But for the older firearms and the quality stuff and the stuff you got on from legacy and from your family, you can prematurely age something that might have been better off dirty if you clean it wrong. All right. On most cases, you can take your firearm apart. We're talking about the semi-automatic right now. Your Glocks, 1911s, quite a few firearms that are popular now. You can take it apart and that barrel piece just comes right off in your hand. Keep in mind that semi-automatic pistols need special chamber attention. Revolvers have six chambers versus one chamber for the automatics. A fouled or rusted chamber and shoulder will cause a failure to chamber, a failure to lock, a failure to fire, a failure to unlock, a failure to extract, or a failure to eject. Now, each one of those things I just said is what? You know what I'm talking about? I just threw failure in front of chamber, lock, fire, unlock, extract, and eject. All those things all known as? Well, guess what? I'm not going to tell you. I'm going to let you email me, blackmanwithagun@gmail.com, and see how many people remember the question. Remember to send me a note. Just curious to see how many I get. Normally, believe it or not, podcasting, because it's time sensitive, or not time sensitive, it's time, whatever, neutral. You listen to it and you feel like it. I might get an answer 6 months from now. or of the 20,000 people that are listening to this show, I might only get one. So for what's 3% of 20,000? Is 600 right? Man, that would be a lot of responses, which never happened. But I digress. Basic principles dictate that you clean from breech to muzzle. If you go in the opposite direction, what will happen? Right, you'll push or pull that bore residue and dirt into the chamber. But what if you do have a revolver? Well, the only part that you're going to be actually doing backwards is the barrel itself, because it's fixed and you can't get it going the other direction unless you use a snake. And I haven't seen any ones that are really good that way. But in the 6 chambers or the 7 or the 8 chambers that the revolver will have, that one you want to make sure that you push your bore brush and your patches in the direction that the bullet will be traveling out. So you got everything in the revolver chamber itself going out toward the barrel. The barrel itself in reverse, because you can't get in there that well. But again, making sure that you are careful on how much lube you put in there, how much solvent you put in there, and which way you're using the brush, the bristles, the swab, however you're doing it. I've always learned that a little bit is better, because oil, even the amount that you have on your hand, is sufficient. Believe it or not, it seeps into the metal and it stays. After you clean your firearm and you're starting to dry everything off, if you set for a little while and come back, you'll be able to put, you'll see another bunch of oil or residue on everything that you just finished, because the oil now has permeated back through the metal. Just letting you know how much you don't have to be greasy. Okay? And when doing rifles, the most important rule of gun cleaning is to always clean from the breech to the muzzle in the direction of the bullet. There's no exceptions to this rule on rifles. If you go in the wrong direction, muzzle to breech, you'll be bringing that what? Power residue and abrasive dirt from the barrel into the chamber in the neck. And that's going to cause a whole bunch of other issues. So you don't want to do that. I have no experience in it, but the new bore snakes look pretty tight. They look like they do a good job. Check those out. Do some reviews on it and let me know what you think if you've never tried it. On shotguns, the bore of a shotgun should look smoother and more polished the more you shoot and clean it. If you notice lead or plastic in the barrel, you'll also see scratches. And the scratches are caused by going back and forth with cleaning stuff. The abrasive dirt in the muzzle was brought back into the chamber and the forcing cone. Conventional cleaning equipment will not clean that forcing cone. This dirt is fired down the barrel and scratches happen. The scratches will lead to lead and plastic sticking to the bore. So if you clean the chamber and forcing cone and only go in the direction of the projectile, the bore will not be scratched. It is no longer necessary to disassemble a shotgun for cleaning like it used to be. Just open the action as you would to insert a shell. Run a flexible steel rod down the barrel and pull that patch out through the bore. Only takes about a minute to correctly clean a shotgun. And for all you podcasters and firearms instructors out there that are trying to make some money off this thing, there are quite a few people who are selling bore cleaner, lubrication, everything from bacon smelling stuff to, I don't know, you name it. No matter what you use, don't use too much of it. I know my friend Todd Jarrett is a big man for Hoppy's number 9. It's been a traditional thing. There's some old school folks out there with the Break Free. There's quite a few different brands. I'm not going to say which one works best, because your mileage may vary. Clean is clean to me, if what you have works. But do know that some stuff is not made to clean a firearm. Do know that it's not all equal too. So make sure that you're buying something that's made for a firearm. Some things that you can put in your kit would include a degreaser, some type of solvent, some lubricant, a tube of like silicone, and maybe even what else for extra credit? Probably just something that says bore cleaner, straight up. Since 2014, I have been a member of the Crossbreed holster family. If you carry concealed, get a holster that supports not only your firearm, but your freedom, the faith, and this brother with a try-it-free lifetime guarantee. Crossbreedholsters.com. Crossbreedholsters.com. Hey, you might not know it, but I've been podcasting since 2007 with this show, and I've had over 200 guests in different avenues, different venues, different businesses, all kind of stuff. And way back in the beginning, when LuckyGunner.com first got started, I got a chance to get one of their people as a guest. I think it was like 2008, somewhere about there. Where were you back then? Here is a interview I had with a friend from Lucky Gunner. And the stuff that he's saying then is happening right now. If you check out the site, I mean, right now, it's the craziest ammo shortage I've ever seen. It even beat 2008. But listen to this.
Ryan, welcome to the Urban Shooter Podcast.
Thank you for having me, Ken.
Man, tell me about Lucky Gunner.
Pretty simple. Online ammunition retailer. Started back in March of 2009 and been growing like a weed ever since. And we sell just about every type of ammo that you could you could ever need, whether it's handgun ammo, rifle ammo, rimfire ammo, shotgun ammo. We've got all different calibers, and then we've also got reloading supplies. So if you're wanting to reload your own ammo, we've got primers and casings and bullets. So we strive to be the one-stop shop for all things that go bang in your weapon.
Oh, that works for me, man. So that's LuckyGunner.com.
Yeah, Lucky Gunner.
This has been a big surge. Everybody's saying, well, it's hard to find X type of ammo. Have you heard that too? What do you do with that?
Yeah, we actually the company was based on two, I don't want to call them trends, but as a result of the recession, mm-hmm. and as a result of Obama being elected, the demand for guns and ammunition, it really spiked towards the end of 2008, and that carried through early 2009. And so a couple of the other co-founders of the company saw that it was essentially impossible to get a couple key calibers online regularly. Things like 45 ACP ammo and 380 auto ammo, they were extremely hard to come by. And so the couple of the co-founders, we got together and set out a premise of finding the hard to find ammo that the other retailers didn't have. And then when we had it, we displayed it on the site, and we would have a live inventory counter on the site that reflected exactly how much of it we had in stock. So those two things really resonated with a lot of the folks who owned weapons. The fact that they could order from us and they would get it, typically within 1 to 2, maybe 3 business days, and the fact that we had calibers that people were looking for and that a lot of other sites didn't have in stock. So those were the two factors that really helped the site grow initially.
Oh, that's cool, man. So you got ammo, it's always in stock, you ship real fast, and you guarantee that you got it. And is there a limit to how much ammo a person can buy?
There's not. You can, we actually want you to buy as much as you need and as much as you want. There are a couple limitations around states where we can't ship ammo to. So if you're in Alaska or you're in Hawaii, we can't actually ship ammunition to either one of those two states. And as I understand it, it's because UPS or FedEx won't actually handle air freight that is explosive. So stuff like ammunition, you can't ship through the air, so it goes ground.
Okay, so outside the continental U.S., you can't do it.
Outside the continental U.S., exactly.
All right. 9mm is still my favorite, and you got plenty of that, right?
That sells like hotcakes. Yeah, that's our best-selling caliber.
Oh, good deal. And 45 comes in my close second. That works for me, yeah. Man. That works for me. Are you a shooter yourself?
Yeah, I've got a Glock. It's a 357 SIG, but it's a nice gun. It does the job. We'll put it that way.
That's serious. Yeah, man. That's like a knowledgeable shooter there with a 357 as your concealed carry pistol.
Well, I'm based in California, and they don't give out concealed carry permits out here in California.
Yeah, we got to work on that one.
Yeah, that's a whole other host of issues. It's not whether I can shoot straight. It's a question of if I can even have the gun with me when I need it.
I heard that, man. We're gonna keep working. You keep doing Lucky Gunner like you're doing, and we're gonna work on the activism part from this side.
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah, you're close to where they're making half these goofy laws, you know, coming out of D.C.
Yeah, I'm near the land of Oz. Yes, I'm right here in Emerald City. Hey, Lucky Gunner, your logo, that's kind of a cool logo, man. Tell me about this logo.
Oh, man. All right, so it's essentially this guy Lucky. I mean, that's what we call him, with the little clover leaf in his mouth. Trying to play on the theme of being of getting lucky. If you come to the site and you'll find exactly what you're looking for, and that's essentially Lucky rocking, dude.
Thanks, man.
So I keep an eye on the podcast. I'm curious to hear what I actually sound like on an MP3 but I'll follow up with you via email. It'll probably be tomorrow before I get the email out.
No problem.
Sound good?
Sounds good, man. Have a great evening.
All right. Thanks for calling, Ken.
You're welcome, buddy.
Talk to you later.
All right, man. Peace.
Bye-bye.
If you go to blackmailthegun.com, you'll see the picture under the Lucky Gunner ad with a young lady named Angela with a pretty nice-looking outfit on. Click on that link and see if your ammo is available at luckygunner.com. If you use that link, I'll get credit for your visit. Like, zero money. But still, it's nice to have like 39 clicks. And if you buy something, then boom. Then I get a few pennies. But the way ammo is right now, I'm not expecting too much. But hey, I might get lucky and you might find some ammo. So go to luckygunner.com when you get a chance today. You know what's been happening to me the last couple of days? Over and over again, old friends, pastors, bishops, church people, even my own relatives have been saying, hey, Uncle Ken, can you take me to the range? And I'm going, what? Have you seen the lines at the ranges right now? You think they're giving away free food to so many people at the range right now? It's packed. You have to get one of those little things, little buzzers, and like you're at a fancy restaurant. The waiting lines are like an hour and a half. But I understand you finally got on with the thing and you get it now. Only took you 25 years of me talking. Maybe it wasn't me. Maybe the light bulb finally came on. But see, now I haven't given a class in a couple of years myself. So I'm not feeling real strong about doing all that energy, all that work. You know, training people is tough. Especially when they know you. But I think I'm going to get back in the business of teaching just for a select few. I was a pretty good instructor at one time. But I was just putting out way too much energy and money for what I got back. That's why I quit, truth be told. But we'll see. In 2021, looks like your friend and your brother from another mother is going to have about 5 jobs going back into my Jamaican heritage. Hey, man, you got to have 5 jobs. And maybe 1 or 2, you might get that reference. And on a whole different tip, you know how hard it is to do good? It's really hard. I'm trying to use my podcast here to help pro-gun Second Amendment advocates and activists, firearms instructors, teachers, businesses, advertise their wares, their products, their services. You know how many people take me up on my offer? How many people are knocking down my door to get in touch with, 20,000 people?
Meanwhile,
I'm here. Been here before Google, before social media, before Instagram, before Facebook. Yeah, I'm old. Hey, if you are new to this whole menagerie, check out my book and you learn about me. And there's a nice glossary in the back of all firearms terms that'll make you smarter. You can find it on Amazon right now. It's called Black Man with a Gun Reloaded. And if you don't remember that it's on Amazon, you can go to book.blackmanwithagun.com and it'll take you right there. Yeah, check out that book written by yours truly, Reverend Ken Blanchard. If you are on YouTube or you haven't a chance to see that, go on to blackmanwithagun.tv and see if you can find my channel there. I'm going to make sure that I put the episodes on YouTube from now on. They're just podcast audio only, but they're still there just in case you wanted to listen to it. I know times have been tough for many of us, and we're still going through this COVID pandemic, and folks are tired of this whole mess. But believe me when I tell you that you are enough, that you are a good person. How do I know that? Because you have the same values as people that I care about. And that's why you're listening. This show isn't for everybody, but for those who do know me and I've had a chance to reach out, I have met the best people in my life through this show, through my work as a Second Amendment activist and advocate, that we are on the right side of history. We are the good guys. We are the people that make this world move in a positive way. Sometimes you get downed. Sometimes you get beat up. Folks don't understand you. Folks challenge you. I get it. I understand. I'm just here to tell you that you're okay. You're better than okay. I'm honored to call you a friend. Just in case nobody else has told you this today, I love you. And it's not a damn thing you can do about it. Until next time. Shalom, baby.
To keep in touch with Ken and his cause, head over to blackmanwithagun.com.